Good morning, everybody. I'm Mary Ellen Limer. I'm the current president for the Southeastern Board. And along with Tessa, I'd like to say good morning and welcome you all to the 54th annual meeting of the Southeastern New York Library Resources Council. This is the second year that we've had to do this remotely. Our hope is that this is the last time that we have to do this annual meeting remotely. But as you'll see throughout the morning, through my comments and Tessa's comments, we're pretty adaptable here at Southeastern. This past year is one in which we all faced some challenges and hardships, and certainly some more than others. But for the most part, we all stepped up and we did what we had to do. Like it or not, we just did it. This is especially true for our executive director, Tessa Killian, as well as the staff of Southeastern. Southeastern remained operational during this entire time. We did things differently. Our services to our members sounded different, looked differently, but they were still available. The staff was available. And one point of interest that we as a board have been made aware of is that we had overwhelming attendance numbers at some of our CE programs or other programs. So going forward, this may influence how we do things in the future. For me, I've been around for a long time. Southeastern was something for me that was normal. And I counted on that. It gave me some hope. And I hope that many of you in your interactions with Southeastern this year can say the same thing. So again, thank you for joining us this morning. We're all looking forward to our program and our speakers. And now I'd like to introduce Tessa Killian, the executive director of Southeastern.
Thanks, Mary Ellen. Okay, just wanted to make sure everybody saw where the materials are, since we don't, you know, sometimes if we were in person, we'd have handouts for you. So these are the handouts. We've posted them all to our website, where you'll find the annual meeting program, the 2020 year in review, and the minutes from last year's meeting. But at this point, I'm going to start out with a land recognition. So we're going to take a few minutes and show a video and talk about do this land recognition. So we're broadcasting from the Hudson Valley. I am in Highland, New York, which was land that had been historically populated by the Lenape people. We begin large meetings and events now with this kind of land recognition to honor the people who belonged to this land before colonization and still inhabit these places. So I'm going to play a video where Chief Vincent Mann will explain in his own words the history of this land. The video was created by the Hudson River Sloop Clearwater and is being shown today with their permission.
Our ancestors and the Ramapos have been in this place for probably 12,500 years. Split Rock is utilized as a solstice viewing chamber. It's a ceremonial complex with stones marking the underground waterways. Split Rock was actually one of the last places that our sacred corn ceremonies was recorded in the 1800s. We still acknowledge it, we still utilize it, and we still bring that portal, you know, to life in a sacred way, which is one of the reasons why we are tirelessly trying to protect this place. There is a constant threat, obviously, of development. They can take this mountaintop and remove it. Can you imagine if your house was sitting here to look at Manhattan? I mean, you know, what is that worth to someone? These stones, it's beyond priceless. And it's not worth us to wait and, you know, get a handshake. That's not good enough. The other thing that's very unique about New York is that we have Indian land deeds, which are not upheld today. So there's only a couple of options you know, to protect this place forever. We've always been these people who stored land, took care of the rivers. Under the name Clearwater, the Muncie word for it, Ramapo. Water is life. We believe that Mbi, in our language, is alive. No different than me. No different than the air or the birds. It should have every right that you as a human being has. It doesn't, not in this country. Especially in this time of COVID and other things, you know, it is our responsibility, our inherent responsibility, to actually think about all humankind. For us, this is the center of our world. From this, with our ceremony and our sacred places, we go there, we pray, so that we can help in our own way to right the world.
Okay, so thank you so much to the Clearwater for making this video available to us. Since words are best when they are partnered with action, we have notes about the land recognition that Moshe just posted into the chat and how you can support the ongoing work of the people who should not be gotten or erased from this land. Okay, now I'm gonna go move on and we're gonna give a council report. So Sarah, if you could go to the next slide for me. So I wanna start off today by acknowledging Southeastern staff. Everyone here in this picture and in at Southeastern plays an essential role in the success of our operations, our services, and our programs. So if you don't know us already through our work with you, clockwise from the top left is Zach Spaulding, Sarah Holstead, myself, Carolyn Bennett-Glauda, Jennifer Palmentiero, Liz Gurdon, Kelsey Milner, and in the middle, Moshe Siegel. So this is a picture of us after last year's advocacy work. I don't know why we were so happy. We had just finished 23 meetings with elected officials and we had a little happy hour that night and we all held up our signs and captured a really nice picture of our team. I also wanna take a moment to acknowledge the Board of Trustees. And you've already met Mary Ellen, who gave such a lovely introduction, and we're gonna meet more trustees later in the meeting. We're all pictured here at a board meeting. I think this was November or December. But since this picture was taken, we've said goodbye to Chuck Thomas and Jeff Miller and welcomed Beth and Carla to the board. There are 15 trustees in total representing the membership and in the Southeastern community that we serve. I also want to take a moment to recognize the other groups. One is four of them actually are the advisory committees. So these are folks who provide guidance and support to all of our services. So Kate Bellady is the chair of the CE committee, Matt Thorad is the chair of the digitization committee, and Frank Appel is chair of the hospital committee, and Karen Canopa is chair of the regional interlibrary loan committee, the resource sharing committee. And so I wanna thank them and all the committee members for working with the Southeastern staff to support our programs and services. So bringing it all together and making connections, I think this was a year of connections. So I really want you to, if you have a chance, take a look at that year in review document that we posted on our website, which is a snapshot of all the Southeastern activities from this past year. It lists all the things, all of our members and all the committees that I just mentioned, and all the people who were involved and all the trustees. It also talks a little bit about all of the different benefits of being a member. But one of the things we did last year that I wanna mention was all the planning we did. And one of the outcomes of this planning work that we did last summer was a new mission statement. And you can read it yourself here, but one of the things that I think this new mission statement did or does now is kind of better describe the work of the council and the work that we do. So at this point, I am going to spend a few minutes sharing examples of the way Southeastern provides opportunities for you to connect with one another and what we did this past year. So learning and networking. So our theme is what we learned this year. And I have to say that we had more opportunities than ever for learning and networking, thanks to the majority of events being held online. The library community, you and your libraries, the systems, NYLA, the state library, grassroots groups, grant-funded programs, the councils, we all established a culture of sharing programming for free or at a very low cost. And I think this kind of just sort of happened organically. And we were part of this network of organic and outstanding programming, which meant that our webinars and our special interest group meetings were available beyond our 8 counties. And like Mary Ellen said, we served a record number of people this year. In 2020, we had over 2,600 people attend our events, which, I mean, it was amazing. It was really great. And so we had people as far, I remember seeing somebody from the EDI SIG who was from Las Vegas and people from LA. We had people who just came from all over to attend our programming. So at Southeastern, we hosted a number of programs and work groups called Resilient Libraries, which was managed by Sarah and funded from a grant. And the focus of that program was on disaster planning and recovery. Carolyn also started 2 new special interest groups this year, one for equity, diversity, and inclusion, and to help process issues of social justice. And Emily Dowie was the first convener of this group. The other new SIG was a collection development SIG that started that was facilitated by Deb Booker from Vassar College. We hosted 2 CENICON conferences, one focusing solely on topics related to how libraries pivoted during the pandemic. So if you don't already know, CENICON is our annual conference held in April that features our local library, archive, and museum talent. So many of these events are archived on our website. The SIGs has notes up for every SIG meeting, and there are recordings for all of our webinars. So if you take a look at this word cloud, you can see all of these words came from the activities that we did. So I kind of made it a word cloud just from all of our CE activities. And moving on to hospital library services. We have a very unique program in New York that provides funding for hospital library services. So these services partially fund electronic resources for our hospital members. So by sharing the subscription fees between the hospitals and the state funds, they can really license a core collection of very important medical resources for healthcare workers and doctors. Additionally, through Vital, the service that we started last year, Sarah delivers consulting services to 4 hospitals. So basically, she is their librarian. That's what Vital is. Sarah is the librarian for 4 hospitals. Our work with resource sharing involved some really important improvements to SEAL this last year. So SEAL, for those of you who don't know, is our regional virtual union catalog and ILL tool. Working with Index Data, the company behind SEAL, Zach was able to filter the limits the filter in SEAL to limit searches to lending libraries only. So this was a feature that our members wanted us to include, and we were able to do that from them. We also added the state library as a target in SEAL, which is a fabulous way for our members to identify and borrow the vast collections up in Albany at the state library. And a really cool new feature on a new development in SEAL was that the staff at Vassar College, Ariana Schlegel, and Jessica Cartelli, working with Zach, they were able to create an API for libraries that use ILLiad to connect to SEAL more easily. So that was a really nice feature that they created so that when they're in ILLiad borrowing, they can connect directly to SEAL. So the staff at Vassar did that. And that can be shared with any of our Southeastern members who use ILLiad are welcome to use that API. Kelsey also maintains a collection of training materials, including manuals and videos that she created for SEAL. And she also has an excellent resource sharing guide. So for anybody who's interested in resource sharing, she keeps an updated LibGuide with all of the recent and current resource sharing news. In the areas of digitization, there are several things I'd like to report on today. Jen has been busy helping members adding new collections to New York Heritage and creating online exhibits, which definitely became a priority during the shutdown for increased awareness of people's collections. We saw a 60% increase in usage of your online holdings in New York Heritage, which is pretty impressive. And a recent example of a new exhibit is from the Hudson River Maritime Museum. They just recently put up an exhibit featuring the Mary Powell Steamboat. It was in our June newsletter. And if you have a chance to take a look at that, it is just absolutely gorgeous. Zach did a major upgrade to the site that hosts our newspapers. It's called Viridian. And so if you have a chance to take a look at that, there's kind of a new display for how the papers show up in there. Zach helped our members add new papers too. We have a new newspaper from Palenville. And Palenville, for those of you who don't know, is in Greene County. And we just recently, like within the last week or so, added three new papers from Red Hook. So there's three newspapers in there from Red Hook, which is in Northern Dutchess County. So the newspapers now have well over 500,000 pages. And the site hosts papers from 8 Hudson Valley counties. So that's I'm pretty pleased with that. So there's pretty good representation of our Southeastern membership in the, you know, service area in the newspapers. So a huge undertaking from Jen and Zach this last year has been working with Empire ADC, which is the portal to finding AIDS. This is just, and I know I've mentioned this before, but this year is a big year for Empire ADC. So Empire ADC is a statewide project sponsored by the Empire State Library Network and led by our council. With the help of a steering committee made up of archivists and others who care about finding AIDS, we're ready to relaunch the service with a new form submission tool that Jen has created using the Metro Council's open source Archipelago software. The new site is indexed with software called ArcLight, which was created by the Stanford University Libraries. The launch, both the front end and the new form tool, are slated for in July. So stay tuned and look out for that. We're really excited that that's happening soon. And we've been working really hard on it this last year. So in recent years, we've added some more consulting services. We have a few of these that are, you know, I would consider them on-demand services. And one of them is called Ask a Lawyer. And this is a service for members to get assistance with questions that require legal answers. So the beauty of the way we've developed this service is that, and it's a statewide service, so Southeastern offers it, but so do 7 or 8 of the other councils. And so the beauty of this is that many of the questions and answers are becoming part of a online knowledge base, and that anybody can go in and look at the answer. So Southeastern had a record number of questions this year that were sent to Ask the Lawyer, and many of these were related to the state's rapidly changing executive orders and policies. Starting in July, we're adding a compendium service called Ask the HR Expert. So questions that are related to HR that don't require a legal answer will be addressed by the HR expert. So the two of them are gonna kind of work together in conjunction. We also have our ever popular Tech Talk email that Carolyn sends every week. So the technology help that they provide at Tech Talk, it does expand beyond the weekly emails since they too have a website full of all the recent posts and videos. Every once in a while, we get a message from someone who just thanks us so much for what they learned on in Tech Talk. So it's very, very popular. So just a little bit about our advocacy work. We met with elected officials for an entire week at the end of February to discuss the value of libraries and to ask for their support. The Ramapo-Catskill Library System and the Mid-Hudson Library System led these efforts. And we attended the meetings along with the members and the school library community. This was a week-long celebration of library love and support, as you can see here in this picture. So even with our champions in Albany, we received flat funding from the state, which is good because our state funding wasn't cut. But advocacy work is definitely ongoing. And right now we're waiting on several bills that are being reviewed in the assembly in Albany. So stay tuned for more information on that. So I'd like to say a few words now about how the Board of Trustees works with us on bigger issues to govern and manage the council. Last July, we held focus groups for members to give us feedback on our programs and services. And then plus we also did a follow-up survey to do the same. And the results of this work were used to guide our planning. So now a year later, we have a new plan that was just recently approved by the State Library. And this plan outlines the goals of our services beginning in July. So I just want to go over a few of the new goals, things that we are doing this year that are kind of different than in the past. We plan to implement services that provide a platform to members to prepare for leadership roles. We are going to help members anticipate and communicate about changes in policies, platforms, and tools used in their libraries so their organization can make informed strategic decisions related to Southeastern services. And we plan to continue to foster a culture of equity, diversity, and inclusion in libraries and cultural heritage organizations. The outcome of this goal is to reflect the diverse communities served by our members. The board also helped us to secure two PPP loans, one which has already been forgiven and one that is still active. And the board also at their May meeting passed a budget for the new fiscal year. And this is a guide for our revenue expenses for beginning in July. So my plug here for our upcoming events. So I just want to share some things that are coming up this summer. We're taking advantage of our yard and the summer weather to host several of our SIGS meetings in person outside. Also this summer, the Empire State Library Network's Pillar Symposium is happening. This is for librarians and educators to learn about student readiness for college. That's in July. And also save the date, for in the fall, we're having a Fall into Books, the Children's and Young Adult Literature Conference is happening in October. And that the Fall into Books Conference is a project that is coordinated and sponsored by all of the systems in the Southeastern region. So the 5 BOCES school library systems, Mid-Hudson, RCLS, and Southeastern. So there are more events on the calendar. So keep a lookout for those. And Carolyn sends out a comprehensive list every week that includes all Southeastern programming and all of the regional and statewide programming. She puts together in a nice email list for you. So the last, I just wanna have a couple closing comments here. I just wanna say that it's the work of the board, the staff, committees, our SIG conveners, the members, you all who use our services, it's all of you that make what we do possible. So the success of this organization belongs to all of us, and we see it in how you serve your communities. So thank you for being part of this network of people and organizations and work who have stayed focused on delivering excellent library services during a time of changing situations. So thank you.